Christmas Eve service at First Methodist Church here in Forney. We're so glad that you're here. For those of you who may have missed it, there are announcements and also the call to work or the worship orders are over on each of the tables, and you may go and take pictures of those. And as well, if you will look in your seats, you will notice there are some ornaments in each set of seats, and they look something like this. And say First United Methodist Church on the front. These were done by the Lord's Army, which is our mission outreach group of our children's department. And these are a gift to you for Christmas, to hang on your Christmas tree. So we're so excited to be able to give these to you as your gift tonight. In addition, you should have been handed a brochure from Methodist Home in Waco. Methodist Home is, well, as they say, it is a place where children are able to go if they are no longer able to live at home for one reason or another. That's kind of what they say about it. It is a wonderful place. It is one of the very best things we do as Methodists. And there are the brochures have an offering envelope, and every Christmas Eve it is our custom to take up an offering for the Methodist Home in Waco. Additionally, poinsettias, if you wish tonight, if you have bought poinsettias, you may take some home with you this evening. And so we asked you to do that. We wanted to keep them tonight for Christmas. So you may take them home with you. There is a page that has those gift poinsettias given in honor of or in memory of someone. Also, in donations to the student building. And I believe at this time, that is all I have to announce. Gina, are there any instructions that I need to give that I may have forgotten? If you would please stand and stay in your places and turn and greet one another in Christian love. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel.
Prophets. It reminds us that prophets like Isaiah listen to God. so that they can show us the way to Bethlehem. Let us enjoy the light of the prophets. Let us enjoy the light of the Holy Family.
Thank you.
spirits, for angels also came to them.
Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
This is the candle of the shepherds. It reminds us of the good news, a Savior, the special Son of God, is born. Let us enjoy the light of the shepherds.
Bring a gift of gold for the newborn king.
I bring a gift of frankincense for the newborn king.
I bring a gift of myrrh for the newborn king.
This is the candle of the Magi. It reminds us of gifts, of God's gift of Christ, the newborn King. Let us enjoy the light of the Magi.
Born in a manger, who came to save the world.
Let us now present God with his tithes and our offerings with the ushers come forward. Mighty God, we come to you on this most solemn of evenings, this night where this world in a real sense stood still. Creation itself was focused upon the birth of the child. The great stars shone, the planets were aligned. The whole universe witnessed in this coming. The greatest gift that could ever be given. Gift of the Son of Christmas, our Savior, Jesus Christ, the Emmanuel, the Lord. We give our gifts tonight in honor of him and in memory of the gifts of the wise men, and again in the gift of that most precious Son whom God gave to us. Amen. Thank you.
Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 20. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. In those days, went out from Caesar Augustus, that all of the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. Verses 1 and 2 of Luke chapter 2 are most significant. They're significant because they place the birth of Jesus within the framework of time and space history. And for this reason, we can conclude that the birth of Jesus was a real and objective fact. It is clearly deduced that Jesus was born to real parents in a real place in real time. Jesus came into human history. Jesus' birth was no myth, and it was no profound fiction. It was a real event with the most pivotal influence of any other event upon human history. Today's progressive historians, politicians, and yes, even theologians want to tell us we who believe in the traditional understanding of the Christmas story, we who believe that it is real, that it did happen. They wish to tell us to be very careful, or we will be on the wrong side of history. That is, unless we are willing to change and alter our understandings of the Nativity story to fit a more modern and progressive political framework, that we would be left behind, and the Christian message and Christianity itself will lose significance if we're not willing to change it. In other words, there is a current effort, even within the Christian church, to rewrite the Christmas story, to make it more relevant, yes, politically correct. What these self-proclaimed woke individuals are missing is that the Christmas story and the Word of God itself is not a matter of human invention. It's not something we make up. Further, we're not at liberty to recreate or even create history. We merely uncover history. We don't devise it. We seek our best, to do our very best to uncover what God has revealed to us in time and space. You see, God is the master of time. He is the master of history. For the Christian, all of human history is the unfolding of the redemptive acts of Jesus Christ. The most crucial event in human history was revealed by the prophets in Micah chapter 5, verse 2, which reads, "But you, O Bethlehem and Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth one from me, one who is to be ruler of Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient days." It is then recorded in a more brief and simple span in Luke chapter 2, verses 6 and 7, where we read, "And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." The most crucial and the most staggering event in human history is recorded in these two very brief and basic verses. You see, history is, listen carefully, His story. History is His story. Christ is the central focal point of all human history. All of history, all of life revolves around the revealing of the birth of the Christ child. The Romans were concerned with seemingly more important things, like the collection of taxes, which this is the scene. This is their 15th of April. While they were concerned with the things of the world, political things, God was concerned with the salvation of the world. Warren Wisby, the great Christian writer, said, "Try as you might, you cannot escape the birth of Jesus. His birth has affected every aspect of the human world. It has affected commerce, it has affected politics, and yes, it has affected history itself. The child born in Bethlehem was more than a mere king. The child born in Bethlehem was God Himself. God born into a span of human life. From the voice of the angels and the shepherds, we hear that clear call. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." Merry Christmas. Let us now go to our Holy Communion. Christ, our Lord, invites all to His table who love Him and earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love. We have not loved our neighbor, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray, and free us from joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and so with your people on earth and all of the company of heaven, we praise your name with joy and your name in heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, he gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin or death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Would the ushers come forward? While they are distributing the elements, I have some instructions to give. Those of you who have been attending during this time of the COVID virus, you understand how to do this. Others of you may not be familiar, but these cups have two tabs. There is one of cellophane on the top, and when you remove it, there is the wafer underneath that. There is a second tab. It is a little thicker. There is a little thicker end on it, and you lift it up. You have the blood of Christ. I believe that. I will wait and we will take it together. Ushers, if you would please distribute the elements.
Thank you.
Candlelight is one of the most solemn of all worship services within the Christian church. And each of you should have a candle. If you do not, please raise your hand and the ushers will bring you one. Some simple instructions. The ushers will come forward and will take the light. Then they will go to each end and light the candles of those of you on the ends, and then you will pass the light to each other. Now, those of you who have a lit candle, you hold your candle straight up, and the person whose candle is not lit, let them tilt theirs, therefore you do not get wax all over yourself. So if your candle is lit and you hold it up, then allow the one without a lit candle to lean their candle toward yours in order to take the light. We will not join outside because it is rather cold and blustery. Our participation will be inside at this time. Light shone in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it.
Oh.
bless you on this holy eve.